Thank you both so much for being with me today.
You're very welcome.
Wish this were under different circumstances, but thank you.
We all do. Let me begin with you, Barbara. What is your favorite memory of Alison?
Oh, there are so many. She came into the world lighting up the room that she walked into. And she was full of mischief. I remember one time that we thought that we had her in a place where she couldn't do anything as a child, and I came in and she had found a red magic marker and drawn all over the coffee table in our living room and the carpet and the kitchen floor. But you couldn't be mad because this little golden girl smiling that she'd done this wonderful piece of art. She's always been like that. She was full of love and life, and she was a geek at heart, which is the greatest compliment that I can ever give anyone.
Barbara, tell me, what is your last memory of Alison? Because I know it was just her birthday, and you had just taken this amazing family trip to literally her favorite place in the world.
My last memory is on Tuesday. I was at work, and she would always call after work on her drive home. She would call, and she'd always say, just checking in. And she said, ugh, I'm so tired after that trip, because her schedule was so unusual. And on our vacation, we slept in, and we laughed, and we ate more than we should, and we had such a lovely time. And then she had to go back to the unusual schedule that she had. But she always had a smile, regardless of the circumstance. And I think that Alison and I had a very, very unique relationship, unusual by any standards. If she was going shopping, and she always said when I'd come up to Roanoke with her, she said, when you come up here, I end up spending money, because we would go shopping for her wardrobe that she would wear, and I could tell her spot on what looked perfect on her and what was the right thing for her to wear. And she knew it, and she respected that, and she always wanted me there when she was buying her clothes.
Tell me about her drive as a journalist, because I think all of us in the business and everyone watching, it marvels at all she achieved by age 24. What drove her?
She just, you know, I think that's just the way she came into this world. Everything she touched, every activity that she picked up, you know, she excelled at everything. I mean, she wanted to be the best. I mean, she was just extremely competitive. And whatever she did, and maybe she, you know, I'd like to, maybe she got that from me, from Dad, because, you know, if I pick up a sport or if I pick up an activity, and as you will, you know, we'll talk about later, you know, now with this mission, you know, I want to be the best. And I've always been that way. And it just sort of was instilled in her that, you know, you go at it. And, you know, thankfully she was just gifted. I mean, she, beyond belief.
She was.
She tutored calculus at James Madison University. And, you know, how many journalism majors can tutor calculus? I mean, it was that kind of thing. I mean, she was an incredible athlete. She was an incredible whitewater kayaker. But she just was not satisfied with just, you know, doing something. She wanted to be the best.
She wanted to be the best. And when she set out to do something, she meant that. She wanted to be the best and never lose a race, never mess something up. She wanted everything she did to be perfect, and she was driven to do that.
Do you find in Alison's passion the strength now to fight this fight, Andy and Barbara, to fight your passion, which is changing some of the gun laws in this country?
I like to think that she got her strength from me and her passion from her father. And I always looked at her and thought, the genes just aligned, and how often does that happen? And she was absolutely the best of both of us. We're both passionate about what we do, passionate about the arts, passionate about the things that we feel are right and important. And she had that. She had that passion from day one.
And now we're passionate about a new mission. And, you know, it's the only thing that's given me strength right now to go to take on this cause, because, you know, I know that somewhere she'd be looking down and saying, "You go, Dad. This is what she would want me to do." This is her fight.
It is her fight, and I can see Alison sitting there going,
"Yeah,"
because that's what she'd do. It's like, good job,
Mom and Dad, we do that for her. I'm sorry, go ahead, Poppy.
Barbara, you have said this was the happiest point in her life. She was madly in love with Chris. She was working at her hometown station where she wanted to be. That was with the utmost evil stripped away from you, stripped away from your community, stripped away from this world. So I want to know more about your fight. Barbara, where do you go from here?
From here, you can't change the world in a day. I mean, that's been proven, that you can't change the world in a day. But we cannot be intimidated. We cannot be pushed aside. We cannot be told that this fight has been fought before and that we're just one more grieving family trying to do something. Because I've looked in the camera on other interviews and I've said, if you are a parent, if you're a mother, if you have children, can you look your child in the eye and say, we are willing to allow you to be collateral damage in order to keep what some people perceive as their constitutional rights? If we as a society are willing to accept that, what kind of society are we?
On Friday, I interviewed Senator Chris Murphy of Connecticut, and I want to play you part of what he said to me. Who are you talking about in Congress?
I'm talking about the entirety of Congress, especially those that have stood in the way of common sense gun measures like expanded background checks or reforms to our mental health system. The fact is that when, you know, our leadership in Congress stands up and says, we can't do anything, they are absolutely wrong. And I believe that we have become complicit in these murders because people listen to the highest levels of government.
Andy, I know you want to go to Washington. What will you tell Congress?
Well, Senator Murphy is absolutely correct. And, you know, I think every time there's been one of these tragedies, you know, we all say, well, this is the tipping point. You know, this is, you know, something's going to get done after Newtown, after Aurora, after, you know, Gabby Giffords was shot. I mean, you know, you think, well, something's going to get done. This time, I think that the circumstances of this tragedy, they're different. They're different this time. It has been not just another, you know, well, gee, gunman goes in and it's all horrific. But because of who Alison was, I mean, you know, she was a rock star and she had such potential behind her. Alison would be really mad at me if I didn't take this on. And I promise you, and I've said this time and again, these people are messing with the wrong family. We're going to affect a change and it's going to happen. And we need people like Senator Murphy and Governor McAuliffe who are courageous enough to stand with us. And we will affect a change.
Barbara, I'd like to read for you part of a letter from one mother to another this morning. Nicole Hockley, who lost her beautiful 6-year-old son, Dylan, in the Sandy Hook shooting, wrote an open letter this morning in the paper, and it reads, "I understand the overwhelming need to make something positive come from this, the need to save lives as part of your daughter Allison's legacy. I can see the shock in your eyes and the potent mixture of anger and grief bubbling under the surface, threatening to overcome you at any time. I have insight into the journey ahead for you and can sadly say that it will not never get easier. But there is hope, and that is what you need to hold on to. People say, if Sandy Hook couldn't deliver change, Nothing will. I disagree. What do you say, Barbara?
I absolutely agree with that. You think that how could that many children be killed and nothing happen for it to be ignored? But what we have to do is, there are people out there whose minds we will never change. They are the people that are unimportant in this fight. The people who are important of this fight are the silent majority who feel the way we do, that some kind of gun control measures are necessary.
Even the NRA, the majority of NRA membership supports, reasonable, closing of loopholes and making it harder for mentally disturbed people to get guns. And as Mark Kelly, mentioned, and I know this, this is not a sprint, it's a marathon. But I'm in it for the long haul. We're in it for the long haul. I look at you and I see Allison. I mean, she was like a little sister. You could have been sisters. And, I think why this is different this time is that, that could have been you out there. And that's what I challenge the journalists. And I think that's why it's different. You guys are going to stay with us because she was one of you. She was one of the fraternity. And, that's why this thing is not going to go away, and that's why it's not going to be different, because she was one of you. And Poppy, it could have been you. And we don't want that to happen. We don't want another tragedy like this to happen.
It's horrible to think that journalists have to go through the rest of their lives looking over their shoulder or wondering, is there somebody out there that's going to come after me? And that shouldn't happen to anybody. To live your life in fear is not living.
No.
And no one should have to do that.
I know that, we see all these images of her on TV. She could have a lot of fun on morning television, dressing up in costumes. I mean, but her heart lay with hard news, and she was working on a child abuse special called Childhood Lost.
Yes.
I wonder what she wanted to give the world, Barbara, with her stories.
That story was especially important to her. She spent many, many hours with the little girl who was the feature that we call Hope, and her adoptive mother, and talking about the things that she'd gone through. And Allison knew that she was one of the lucky ones. She had a loving family. She grew up with a lovely home, and she had what so many people do not have, and she realized that. And for this little girl to be so eloquent and so beautiful in telling Allison her story, that it broke Allison's heart, but she felt like that story was so important to be told.
And she was so proud of it.
Very proud of it.
She was so proud of it, and she said, "Dad, this could be, this thing could win an Emmy." And so, being proud dad that I am, I posted on her the promo for it, and I said, you people watch this, because it could be, this could be an Emmy Award winning piece. And she called me up immediately. She was so sensitive about this stuff. She said, "Dad, you can't say that. This is making me look like I'm bragging on myself. Take that off of there right now." I mean, her ethics were, she would, I was trying to, I was proud dad and still am proud dad. But, she was so careful and so modest and humble.
Finally, I do want to also honor Adam's family as well.
Absolutely.
Obviously, they are grieving in their own way, but I know you've been able to spend time
yes.
with them. Is there anything you'd like to say on their behalf or just about Adam?
We are public people. For years and years, we've been in positions where we work with the public, we talk to the public, we're comfortable talking to the media. And this is how, in a large way, we deal with our grief, is by telling our story. Not everyone is like us, and we respect so much Adam's parents and his siblings, because they are much more private people, and they're grieving in their own way. So this fight is for them too. We are not only the spokespeople for Allison, we are the spokespeople for Adam, for the WDBJ family, for all of the people who are suffering because of this. And anything we do is in not just Allison's name, but in their names also.
Please tell me about the fund that has been set up at Allison's alma mater, where people can donate to help aspiring journalists.
JMU set up a scholarship. I guess it was Thursday. They said, when it hits $25,000, one of their largest alumni or biggest donors would match it if it was 25, if it hit 25,000. Well, in less than a day, it was 25,000. Now it's 50,000, and it is an endowed scholarship that will be there in perpetuity. But now we, absolutely can keep contributing to that fund. There's also another scholarship fund for Patrick Henry Community College, where she got an associate's degree and was this year named one of their distinguished alumni. The outpouring of love and affection has just been overwhelming, and we appreciate everyone's love and support.
I am so sorry that I never got to meet her, but I am so glad that she had such an impression on so many. Andy and Barbara, thank you both.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you, Poppy.